Yes. Anyway, thanks for all coming. I've come to speak about the second Summer of Love, which was basically, strangely, over two summers, 1988 and 1989. It was to do with the acid house revolution that happened initially in the UK. And before I start, though, I want to play a piece of music for you. So listen to the lyrics and everything on this, and I'll talk about it afterwards. Not this piece of music.
How did that get in there?
Can you start with the
beginning of it? San Francisco, be sure to wear.
Played you that is for a second Summer of Love, there has to be obviously a first Summer of Love. First Summer of Love was 1967. Basically it sprung out of what was happening in San Francisco. The track you just heard, Scott McKenzie, San Francisco, Be Sure to Wear Flowers in Your Hair, was a release on the surface. And when I was a kid growing up, hearing that record, I mean, it was a massive tune. I think it sold 10 million around the world or something. It took those fives worldwide. And it was always a distinctive record. I didn't quite understand the implications of it, what it was about, but the writer of the song was John Phillips of a band called The Mamas and the Papas. And what happened in January of 1967, within the hippie community that had built around Haight-Ashbury, San Francisco, they had like this idyllic life that they loved. It was all peace, love, LSD was about at the time. And they had this community that was growing, an alternative community. But they were aware that summer, that area was going to be invaded from all parts of America, and indeed probably people coming from different parts of Europe and stuff, to find out what was happening. So the song was in effect to say, if you come in to San Francisco, come in peace, wear flowers in your hair. You know, there's going to be a love-in. It's talking about what's actually going to happen. And sure enough, what did happen is, in the summer of 1967, just a deluge of people came in. You know, people talk about 1967 as the summer of love, but by the end of that summer, the original people in Haight-Ashbury actually did an event called the Death of Hippie. They said it was all over. And it was all over, in a sense, because with the positive thing that happened out of it, the opposite side of the coin, there's always a negative. For every action, there's an equal and opposite reaction. And, you know, what you got was lots of kind of runaways who came there, people who were chancers who wanted to kind of make things off these peaceful people, these loved people. I mean, it had all come out of, as I say, January 1967, there was a major event in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park with the hippie community called the Human Being, also the Gathering of the Tribes, where all different factions of people came together to basically talk about this new way that was developing. They had, you know, some of the great psychedelic figures of the time, like Allen Ginsberg, Chet Helms, famously Timothy Leary. It was at this event where he told the people to turn on, tune in, drop out, which in a sense was a very reckless thing to do, because a lot of young people got caught up in this. And the back end of what happened with the whole hippie thing at Haight-Ashbury was that the bad drugs came into it. A lot of people became heroin addicts. There was all sorts of awful things, like young girls. There was gang rapes. There was all sorts of bad stuff that went down. And, you know, the area degenerated to the level where, when George Harrison from the Beatles, he was the only Beatle to actually visit the area, he likened it to the Bowery, which was a region of New York in, I think it was the back end of the 1800s, where there were drunks and down and outs. So it was a beautiful moment, but didn't last. Now, let's move on to the second Summer of Love, which has a lot of parallels. I mean, the reason that... I don't actually know where the term came from, who coined that. I think it was possibly one of the newspapers that came up with this, but how it all worked out was in 1987, the summer of 1987, a group of DJs from London went to Ibiza. They were Danny Rampling, Paul Oakenfold, Johnny Walker and Nicky Holloway. They went for a holiday. It was Paul Oakenfold's birthday. There was another DJ over there called Trevor Fung and his cousin, a guy called Ian St. Paul. And basically, they took them to a club called Amnesia, where there was a DJ, an Argentinian, who was working out in Ibiza called Alfredo. He was known for this Balearic approach to music, which was really an eclectic, playing this and that all together. So there was bits of like house music, there were bits of like kind of pop music, rock, everything was played together. The thing that happened to that night was those four DJs took ecstasy for the first time, which Trevor Fung had introduced them to. They had a revelation, just had this most amazing time and thought, we can bring this feeling back to the UK. We can start to, you know, like our Balearic kind of wonderland, we're gonna kind of try and translate to Britain, which is exactly what they did. I mean, they came back from that trip and they opened clubs. There was, Danny Rampling opened a famous club night called Shoe. Paul Oakenfold had nights like Spectrum and Future. Nicky Holloway had the Trip. And they tried to take this ethos, this Balearic ethos that they caught out. And of course, on the back of that, coming over with it, was the drug ecstasy, MDMA. Now, this was already in London on the gay scene. There was it had already kind of come in, but it hadn't exploded at all. It was acid house that brought the drug, the music, everything like into a mainstream sense. At the same time in Manchester, you had a different lineage to what was happening. From the black scene, the kids had got into house music alongside the music that was then being played like electro, along with street soul, along with, you know, like the kind of jazzier sides of things that was already a prominent feature on the black scene. But house music started to really make an impression. And this was happening completely separately to what was happening in London at this point in time. So in London, house was only being played really, you know, like on the gay scene or by DJs that were kind of affiliated to the gay scene. Whereas it was very much from the black scene in Manchester where the evolution had occurred. Now, in 1988, these DJs are back, these nights are starting in London. The Hacienda's got this big Friday night called Nude Night that Mike Pickering and then later Graham Park kind of becomes his partner at. And it all fuses in 1988. There's a kind of mythology from a Manchester side that Bez from the Happy Mondays did a gig in London and came back that night with 50 ecstasy tablets, distributed them in the club on a Wednesday night. They had a night called Hot, and that was the start of ecstasy coming into Manchester. Now, by the summer, it had all kind of exploded. And a lot of the symbolism was taken from the 60s, the peace and love ethos of the 60s. And, a lot of the smiley face, as it works out, a lot of people think that's the 60s symbolism, but actually comes from Alan Moore's comic, The Watchman, that basically... there was a single called Beat This by Bomb the Bass, and he used the smiley face on there for the first time. And how you can see it's from Watchmen, it's got the blood that's trickling from the eye. And it's from one of the frames of the comic Watchmen. And so that became... I think a lot of the... For me, a lot of the reasons why the whole kind of acid house era, it didn't hit deeper and more politically and everything. It was a very hedonistic scene. Was because of the borrowed symbolism in many ways. It was kind of reverting back. From a personal level, you know, I was, in the years leading up to this, I was like engrossed within the 60s. I'd stopped DJing in 1984. And so I wasn't like tied to dance music at all. I was starting to listen to all sorts. I'd always listened to all sorts, but I was like concentrating. And I got seriously into the Beatles and what was happening there. And obviously The original Summer of Love album was Sgt. Pepper's. That was the soundtrack of that period. So many things emanate from that, come to that period and go from that period. So when this thing happened, you know, like in 1988, 89, from a personal level, I enjoyed it on the fact that it was a reconnection in many respects to the 60s. So the Summer of Love, as I say, it happened over two summers. I think 88 was probably still working on a more underground level. It was still more people getting connected to this new thing, this new acid house movement that was emerging. By 1989, it had flipped much more into a mainstream context. You know, now everyone, I mean, The Sun for a start, they were the greatest publicisers of acid house by, you know, spreading these scare stories within the newspaper, this terrible new movement that was going to, you know, be the ruin of, you know, the generation of kids that were coming up. Just like before had been said with things like rock and roll and obviously punk and stuff like that. So by 89, as I say, things had reached a real peak, that it had brought in people not just from cities like London and Manchester, Sheffield, Nottingham. These places were connected to dance culture very deeply. It had gone right throughout the whole country. People were absolutely enamoured with this new music. Very different from the States. House music in the States has never been a mainstream thing. It never took off on that level. And perhaps the reason for that is because of what happened during the disco era, the late 70s, where a shock jock, they call him, a DJ on radio, it was a rock station, and at the time, the rock stations were all switching to disco. Disco was massive commercially, it was the biggest selling form of music. I mean, Nile Rodgers, who's playing tomorrow with Chic, in his book he talks about these things and how it was just killed, completely stone dead in 1979. And how it happened was that this DJ, Steve Dahl, started this campaign called Disco Sucks, and it all kind of culminated in a show at Comiskey Park. It was a baseball stadium in Chicago, and during one of the breaks from the match, they had basically a record burning ritual. They told all the people to bring your disco records and to throw them in a pile on a bonfire. You know, not a million miles from what Hitler was doing back in the 30s with books and stuff. And so all the music that was going on there was either gay or black related music. It was very homophobic, it was very racist. But they managed to kind of create a movement that scared the record companies. So by the end of like 1979, the record companies were turning away from disco and moving into rock music. I mean, one of the big components of that, MTV, when MTV started, I mean, it basically had a racist playlist. I mean, they weren't playing any black artists. They were just going back to rock artists. Like from Dire Straits was their kind of headline act, so to speak. And it was only Michael Jackson coming through with his videos a few years later that broke all that down and opened it up. So America had basically put disco in a cultural dustbin. And when house music came along, and famous house DJ Frankie Knuckles came out with the quote that house was disco's revenge. This is kind of what he was talking about, was the fact that now this music is taken from there. But at the same time, hip-hop owes a lot to house music. To disco music. Any form of music subsequently was stemming from what had happened during that period of time. But culturally in America, it kind of cut it off at that point. Whereas Britain, house music became like massive, and that kind of stemmed out into Europe and everything. It's a completely different lineage in America, and America still suffers from that today. There's still parts of America, whereas they would refer to disco as fag music, and you know, they put it down and see it as worthless and everything. Things are slightly changing now, you know what I mean? There's been enough distance of time, but the documentation, and in a little way, it's like, you know, going back over there and playing and speaking to people and everything, it reminds me of what I've read about the way the blues was brought back to America in the early 60s by people like the Stones and the Yardbirds, Spencer Davis. They were like hugely into old American blues records. And so they were doing interviews. They were the hottest things like in the charts, the American charts. And they were saying, who are you into? And they were saying, Lead Belly and Muddy Waters and Robert Johnson, and they're like, oh right, those old guys. And what it managed to do was bring the blues back, and America rediscovered a part of its culture. But with disco, as I say, that's still partly lost. In the UK, house became a huge commercial force. Club culture absolutely changed completely. It went from dance music being, I wouldn't say it was a completely underground thing, but there was certainly major underground part of it. It obviously seeped into mainstream, the bigger tunes, but there was things like the jazz funk scene, electro funk, rare groove in London, all these things were going on. There was specialist music scene based on dance music. Now this started to shift into the mainstream, and this whole kind of acid house rave explosion hit full gear, and we have the club culture. I mean, now as a DJ I travel the world and play. That wouldn't have happened back when I stopped DJing in 84. The furthest I got, I think, was Birmingham or Nottingham. That was exotic, you know, like to get up the M6. But now it's a worldwide, and it's because of the fact that these four guys went to Ibiza and had this experience. I had a vision to bring it back, and at the same time you have people like Mike Pickering, Tony Wilson, Rob Breton, who was New Orleans manager at the Hacienda, who, because of their associations with New York, with New Order going over and touring a certain ratio, Quando Quango, they wanted to bring a bit of New York kind of dance culture to Manchester. And so it's these visionary people that enabled this situation to happen. I'm going to play another track for you right now, which kind of puts you into 1989. I mean, it's interesting, the start of this track. I mean, this track on a personal level is the one that probably more than anything symbolises that era, for reasons that I'll tell you in a minute. But the start of the record is really interesting because, again, it puts you in the time context, because what you've got to remember is that in 1989 we're still at a period where young people, 10 years previously, you know, like, the worst that they had to worry about was, you know, in terms of, like, if they got a sexual disease, was that they had to go to, like, the local clinic and have treatment there. Now, it was their life, you know, AIDS was there, that people were like, and we were also living in Thatcher's Britain, where it was every man for himself, and the youth were being kind of pushed in, closed in. Norman Tebbit was get on your bike, go and find work, get out to the provinces and get to the cities. And it was a time where I think that young people, you know, with this drug ecstasy coming into play, they actually looked at each other for the first time and maybe thought, wow, you know, there's other people. Very tactile, very warm, everybody was matey and, you know, the nice one, and you go to a club and people say where are you from and they look after you, and it was a beautiful moment that existed. And it was during this moment that I heard this particular track for the first time. It turned out to be an Italian track, and it has a lineage as well. I mean, basically it's a track called Rich in Paradise by the FBI Project, which is born out of a 70s track by Lamont Dozier, who was the great songwriter. He used to work for Tamla Motown, Holland Dozier Holland. And he'd done a track called Going Back to My Roots, which was based around the Alex Haley novel Roots, which had basically brought the black experience of America. There was a huge TV program and a book and everything. And he built it around that. Now, further to that, Richie Havens, who sadly died this year, very famous folk singer who played at Woodstock, and he did a cover version with this kind of piano intro, which the FBI Project took from, which became a huge Balearic hit. What was already a big jazz funk hit, we knew this track anyway in this country from the jazz funk scene. And in between that, there'd also been a major chart hit of the same record, Going Back to My Roots, by Odyssey. So it was a track already that was in the psyche of pretty much everybody in the country. And, you know, I'll play the track now, but I was listening to this track within one of the alcoves at the Hacienda one night, and I'll explain about it after you've heard it.
Hey, you, don't be silly. Come on. We'll be right back.
fade that down because we've got limited time, but the piano breakdown in that, now, in the Hacienda on the bottom floor, there were all these different alcoves underneath, and the dance floor is behind you there. The DJs are up top, the booth is up there. I was stood talking to a friend of mine, actually he's appearing here, he's doing poetry later today, a friend called Kermit. I managed a band called the Rap Assassins at the time. I was living in London, but I came back to Manchester. I was in the Hacienda. Everyone was on one, as they say, back then. And we were talking in one of these alcoves, and this record was playing in the background. And as the piano breakdown came in, and I was just talking to him, he continued talking, but his hands moved up in the air, like a few people before. And as I looked around that alcove, everybody was saluting. And I turned around and looked, and everybody in the club, it was the most unified moment. I've worked in clubs for many years, worked in many great clubs, great scenes. But in terms of somewhere being everyone together, unified, I've never experienced a moment like that. It was a beautiful moment. And, you know, I often kind of give that as an example of what the Hacienda was like at its absolute peak. Now, sadly though, I mean, these things come to an end, and I often think that for something to be that special, there has to be a back end of it, there has to be a negative side comes in. The same thing happened, as we said, with the first Summer of Love. This beautiful moment, it got infiltrated, and it went negative in the end. It went wrong, and, you know, it dissipated. The same thing happened, really, in the Hacienda. What was going on in a literal sense was that ecstasy was available, but it cost £15 to £20 for a tablet, which was a lot of money. A lot of people actually started taking LSD around about this time because it was so cheap. And even though it was a completely different type of drug, that kind of came into the scene as well. Another connection back to the 60s. But the Hacienda was made up by a lot of different factions of people. And, you know, you'll know like bands like the Happy Mondays, who later have like big success, were coming from a more kind of scally kind of, you know, attitude. And some of the lads that were coming in with them, you know, like a lot of the black kids that were coming in there as well. And there was different factions of people, and with these factions came people that were maybe not so much into the music, but could see for themselves that if ecstasy cost 15 to 20 quid for one single tablet, there was a lot of money to be made. And what happened eventually is it's like the wolves came in on the sheep, and they took over the drugs trade in the club. Eventually they closed the club down because the threats to the doorman, the police couldn't control the situation. The gang culture started to emerge in Manchester as a result of this. Guns started to come into Manchester, which had never been there before, and different factions of gangs. And sadly, you know, like to kind of take that full circle and give another example, it didn't seem like it was that long later. Maybe it was 12 months later, and I could have been in exactly the same alcove, and I was talking again to Kermit. So, you know, it was a bit of a deja vu thing. But this time, as I looked across to the side, I saw a guy pull a girl by the hair across a table. It was brutal. It was very heavy. And your natural reaction, you move towards it. What's going on here? And as I moved towards it, I felt a hand on my chest. And it was like, stop. And it was explained to me. He explained what was going on. That now, every alcove on the bottom of the Hacienda was run by a gang. There was Cheetham Hill, that was their alcove. There was the Gooch in Moss Side, that was there, the Salford. And that's what it was. And the only reason I was stood in that alcove in the first place was because who I was stood with. If had I just wandered in on my own and decided I was going to sit down, you know, people getting, you know, beaten up just for kind of going in the wrong place. And that was the end of it for me. You know, I speak to people about the Hacienda, and they'll say, I used to go to the Hacienda, and I say, when did you go there? And they'd say, in 1994. And I think, no, you went in the building, you went in the space, but you weren't in that club. I remember taking somebody from Detroit there, probably about 91, it wasn't that far after this. And, you know, they'd heard all about this amazing club. And we went in there, and the DJ was playing kind of indie dance classics. It was like a studenty thing. It was a lot, you know, a lot of alcohol-based stuff. It was like that kind of Eid up happy vibe had gone, and it was just a pale reflection of what it once was. But that moment, and that moment that they call the Summer of Love, was a special time, just as the Summer of Love in the 60s was a magical moment of possibility where young people, what was available to them all of a sudden broadened, you know, and it's changed things culturally, like massively, like in the intervening time. But as I said, these things don't last forever, and, you know, but let's hope that, you know, at some point we've got a third Summer of Love coming up and a new generation takes a hold and says, we're having this, and maybe, you know, learns a few of those lessons from the past in terms of how to stop it from kind of switching and going the opposite way around. So, I hope you enjoyed the talk and everything. We'll ask you a couple of questions if you want to.
Yeah,
you can do that, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Brad. Say massive thank you. I love Greg Wilson anyway. He's absolutely fantastic. He's an amazing, amazing DJ. He totally knows how to get a party started and a crowd going all night. He's absolutely fantastic. But he's also an amazingly intelligent cultural commentator. He brings what seem disparate threads together in a really interesting way of all of our culture and dance culture. And do sign up to his website. He does brilliant blogs at www.electrofunkroots. What time are you on
tonight? It's the Greg Wilson one, which is the blog.
Greg Wilson, okay.
Deals specifically with the early 80s.
Okay, sorry. Yeah. Yeah, so Greg Wilson one. And what time are you on tonight?
1 till 3 at the Late Night Pavilion.
Fantastic. 1 till 3, Late Night. See you there. Yay. Okay, we've got time for literally two questions. So, two lucky people. What do you want to ask Greg?
Come on, no questions.
I'll ask you a question.
Yes, Sarah.
What was your very first memory of music that you like fell in love with music?
Well, I mean, it was always around me from being a kid. Yeah. I lived in a seaside town, and so everywhere I was, there was this amazing 60s music. I was born at that, right into that moment. And then when I was 7, we moved into a pub. We had jukeboxes, we had mobile DJs coming in and out. But I also had an older brother and a sister, and what it really was for me with them, they fortunately, you know, they were into like Tamla Motown, right. Stax Atlantic, all the black music, and they were buying all these wonderful singles.
Brilliant.
And that was my love. That was my first love.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you.
Great. Massive hands in the air for Greg Wilson. You've been amazing.